this is a lecture about food collapse and using Cuba as a case study. I hope in the next few minutes as we talk about this together to look at a specific example of a collapse that occurred within modern times and a collapse that occurred within an active and functioning geopolitical environment. Today's lecture is drawn primarily from two sources. The first is a book called Unfinished Puzzle, The Challenges, Cuban Agriculture, The Challenges, Lessons, and Opportunities. This is a book that was commissioned by Oxfam to look at Cuba's historical food policy and to look at the numbers and some of the statistics behind it. The second book is called Farming Cuba, Urban Agriculture from the Ground Up. And this is a book that's primarily a public planning, a urban architecture book. It's concerned with design and form and looking at that in conjunction with food sustainability and looking at how different architectural forms work to support sustainable food and local food agriculture, urban agriculture, and looking at particularly in the context of Cuba. So Cuba is a country that has gone through a collapse in the recent past. And so for this lecture, we're primarily going to consider it a case study in the collapse of a collapse in food infrastructure. It's a great example because it really pushes back against the idea that collapse necessarily has to look like apocalypse, like everything's shutting down and you're scraping for survival. That's not what happened in Cuba. Instead, Cuba's collapse occurred within the context of a globally connected world, and throughout its challenges, Cuba remained connected in various ways to different parts of the global community. They remained embedded in a very active geopolitical environment, despite the fact that they were experiencing a collapse in their food agriculture. It's important to situate Cuba in the context of its history as well. And just as a caveat, by necessity, this lecture is really going to simplify a lot of Cuba's story and leave out a lot of important details. The story of Cuba's history is told very differently depending on the perspective that the person who's telling the story takes. A lot of different stakeholders in its history, and there's a lot of passionate, different perspectives on this. And I am not going to be able to talk about all of it. I'm going to try and talk about just within the perspective of what Cuba went through is informative for what food infrastructure resilience might entail in the future. Okay, so as a base, Cuba is a nation in the Caribbean that consists primarily of one large island. There's a picture on the map here on the left showing you Cuba in yellow. It's approximately 150 miles south of Florida. It has about 11 million people in it, and that's about 60% of the population of New York State for comparison. 11 million people total, but about 2 million of those people live in the capital city or its surroundings of Havana. This is a quote from one of our books. From the 15th to the 20th century, Cuban agriculture developed in a socioeconomic and political context that was marked by feudal and semi-feudal colonial regimes, followed by neocolonial capitalism. In 1959, an anti-imperialist guerrilla revolution led by Fidel Castro, Che Guevara, Camilo Cienfuegos, and Raul Castro Ruiz started a new chapter in Cuban history with the establishment of a socialist state. So now, in contrast to capitalism, a socialist state is marked by a commitment to government ownership of most of the means of production, and at the same time, cooperative management of the economy. So practically speaking, this means that individuals don't typically own their land, and they're assigned jobs by the government. And the government also decides which industries, which factories, which farms, etc., are going to be built, how they're going to be staffed, what the people that are staffing them are going to be paid, and the prices on many of the goods. Those prices are often set by central planners, and the prices don't change in response to market forces, at least not dynamically in response to market forces. If they change, they change over time. This is a really important part of the story because although socialism, like capitalism, has benefits and weaknesses, the strong control of the socialist Cuban government forced the Cuban society to undertake actions that were important in weathering the food collapse. Some of the strong control was not perhaps what the Cuban people would want, but helped them to establish policies and reacted to policies that the Cuban people were developing on their own that helped them to survive this collapse. Prior to the revolution, prior to Fidel Castro taking over, the majority of the farming land in Cuba was held in large sugarcane plantations. These were ranches or estates called latifundios, and the emphasis here should be on large. These organizations owned about 95% of all large farms in Cuba. 25% of those latifundios, the large farms, were owned by foreign interests, primarily American foreign interests. And in 1957, it's estimated that 10% of the landowners owned 73% of the agricultural land. So this is a statistic that demonstrates a highly unequal distribution of resources in the sector. So 10% of the landowners owned 73% of the agricultural land. All right, so to put that in comparison of what we have in the United States has a much more distributed ownership of land. So as a reference point, in 1993, 8% of the landowners owned 50% of the farmland. So fewer number of people owning less farmland. As another point in comparison to Cuba's unequal distribution of land ownership prior to the revolution, in the US in 1999, the ownership had become more distributed, where 4% of the landowners controlled about 15% of the farmland. And in the US, as in comparison, also as a point of comparison with Cuba's foreign land interest, in the US, only about 1.7% of the farmland is foreign owned or was foreign owned. And most of that was by Canada and the Netherlands. So this is to demonstrate that prior to the revolution, there was a serious and legitimate concern about the unequal distribution of farmland in Cuba and that it was owned by foreign interests as opposed to people in Cuba. And this was one of the reasons that the revolution occurred in the first place. So after the revolution occurred, with respect to agriculture, one of the first steps that the new socialist government did was to repatriate that farmland, making some of it state-owned and then parceling out smaller tracts to the Cuban people. So the land was taken from the people who owned it, foreign interests, the large farm owners, and were managed by the state and given to small Cuban farmers, Cuban farmers who farmed small parcels of land. This was done through the first agrarian reform law in May 1959. And there were two concerns that the revolution was trying to address through this first agricultural reform. The first was the holding of large tracts of land by a few people. And the second was the holding of large tracts of land by non-Cubans. That was the first reform. Well, as a result of the redistribution of American-owned property, basically the property being stolen from the people who owned it, and as a result of the resulting partnerships that Cuba formed with enemies of the US, so the land was taken from US interests, and then Cuba established partnerships, military, security, and political partnerships with US enemies, the US instituted a trade and travel embargo on Cuba, which eventually came to prevent almost all exchange of goods and services with Cuba. And among famously embargoed items were Cuban cigars. The second step that the revolution took with respect to agricultural reform was called the Second Agrarian Reform Law, and that was taken in 1963. This law redistributed medium-sized farms, which were not nationalized by the first law. So first agrarian reform took the large farms, the second one took the medium farms, and these medium farms were also taken over by the state government and parceled out in smaller portions to Cuban farmers. Ultimately, the state ended up taking and owning approximately 80% of these farms and allowed the rest to be owned privately. Together, these moves, these first two reforms, pointed towards a socialist ideal of giving the land to the tiller, or allowing the people who worked the land to own the land. Of course, this came at a direct and very high cost to the people and organizations who previously owned the land and from whom the land was taken by eminent domain.